The year was 2006, and I was in an intro to programming class. The professor was advising us to choose a task for our final projects that was achievable with our current skill level. Chess, he explained, is a good example of a bad idea. Programming chess is much harder than you might think. And I said to myself, someday I'm going to program chess with an AI opponent. It is now 15 years later. I have accomplished my long dormant dream, and I will now attempt to explain how my chess program works simply enough that 2006 me could have understood it. Hello, younger, dumber Kendra. This is Cozy Chess, which you will one day program in Delphi. Note the calm vibe and the slick ability to enter and exit full screen. When users boot up the program, they are treated to a replay of the immortal game, a famous 1851 match between Adolf Anderson and Lionel Kazuritsky. When they click a new game, they can make moves, challenge an AI opponent, and even save the current board state to play again later. So, how does it work? Let's come at the problem of programming chess a bit sideways. Imagine a robot arm beside a wooden chessboard. It knows nothing about chess. It doesn't know that bishops move diagonally or that the goal is to capture the enemy king, but it can see the tiles on the board and pick up and put down pieces with finesse. What are the minimal instructions you would need to tell it for it to reproduce an existing game of chess, say the Immortal Game? Here is the Immortal Game represented in just 180 characters. Each line is a sufficient instruction for our robot arm to carry out one move. 7555 means take the piece at row 7, column 5, and move it to row 5, column 5. 2545 means take the piece at row 2, column 5, and move it to row 5, column 5. The saved games in Cozy Chess are recorded in exactly this format of four numerals per move. In the real world, chess games are recorded in a different shorthand called chess notation that is designed for humans to read. One of the moves in the Immortal Game is written QXA1 plus sign, meaning the queen captures the piece on A1, resulting in a check. That is both too much and too little information for our robot arm. Let's go through it bit by bit. Q. The arm doesn't know what a queen looks like, and suppose we teach it to recognize pieces by shape, it still wouldn't know which piece to pick up because it detects two queen-shaped pieces on the board. We would have to teach it to recognize color and to keep track of whose turn it is. Far easier to feed in what chess notation for humans doesn't include, the starting location of the moved piece. X. The robot arm doesn't need to know whether a capture is occurring or not, so long as when it puts down a piece, it does so with sufficient force to obliterate to dust any piece that might be presently located at that tile. I'll admit that sounds a bit extreme with physical pieces, but the computer chess equivalent is very tame, overwriting. Consider this pseudocode that, as we'll soon see, is pretty similar to the actual code in Cozy Chess. Each tile on the board only knows what piece is currently on top of it. In Delphi, the colon equals sign means gets changed to. So the first line could be read as, "Hey, destination tile, the only piece you need to remember now is whatever one the source tile is currently remembering." In the instant after the first line of code has happened, but before the second line happens, destination tile and source tile are both storing the same piece. Destination tile has forgotten whatever piece it used to know about. That piece has been squashed to dust, or maybe destination tile was empty before. It no longer knows or cares. The second line of code says, "Hey, source tile, the only piece you need to know about now is none." When that code happens, the magic trick is complete. The white bishop or black queen or whatever seems to have moved from one tile to another. This brings us to A1. In traditional chess notation, the tiles are named with the letters A to H, indicating the column, followed by a numeral 1 to 8, indicating the row, where A1 is the bottom left tile from white's perspective. In retrospect, I somewhat wish I just followed that convention in Cozy Chess, but at the time I started coding it, I wasn't used to chess notation, so it felt more natural to me to number the tiles reading style, right to left, top to bottom. Late into the development of Cozy Chess, I added this pretty sheet of notepaper that shows the moves in standard chess notation for users who may like that sort of thing, so I ended up needing to translate between the two systems, but it wasn't that hard. Now, dear Kendra of 2006, before we get to the plus sign, we need to go on a long and circuitous journey into the code, but I'll stick this post-it note in the corner of the screen to remind us to come back to it. This is what the entirety of the Cozy Chess code looks like. This is a list of code libraries that was all auto-generated, except I added MMSystem to play sound effects and math to get random numbers for the AI. This is a list of all the buttons and labels and other objects that appear on screen. That was all auto-generated too. This is a list of all the game's procedures. A procedure is a self-contained block of code that does a job. 2006 Kendra uses the term function to mean pretty much the same thing. There is a difference, but it isn't relevant at this time. The first interesting part we come to is this. What is this? The best thing about programming in Delphi are the data structures called records, which are groups of data defined by you containing as many different pieces of data as you need of whatever type you want. The heart of Cozy Chess is this record I created called Tile, representing a square on the board. It is a group of 9 pieces of data of 4 different types. A chessboard has 64 squares, so I actually needed 64 of these information groups. Now, usually I would ask the computer to give me 64 records with a line of code like this. That would indeed get me 64 of my tile records. They would be auto-named with square brackets board 1, board 2, board 3, etc., all the way to board 64. I could have programmed Cozy Chess that way, but since two very important things to know about a square on a chessboard are which row it's in and which column it's in, I would also have needed to include that information in each record, which I could have done, like so. That would work and would be a perfectly acceptable way to program chess, but I went with this different route. That's called a multidimensional array. It still gets me my 64 squares, since 8 times 8 is 64, but they are now named 1-1, 1-2, 1-3, all the way to 8-8. I think that's slicker, but it's a matter of personal preference. Now let's look at the 9 pieces of data each of the 64 tiles contains. 7 of the 9 are invisible units of information, but 2 are rectangles that the user actually sees. Underlay is the rectangle that holds the background color. If I add a button to Cozy Chess that when you click it runs this code, what do you think will happen? Let's see. It turns the background of the tile in the 4th row, 7th column, hot pink. In my actual game, the fill color of all the underlays is usually set to black or transparent to let the wood grain of the background photo shine through. But the 2 tiles involved in the most recent move are set to sandy brown. A fun exception are the heat maps feature in strategy mode. The second visible rectangle is called Peace Button. It does double duty. First, it holds the actual image of the piece sitting on the tile, if any. The piece art I used for the game was created by Danielle Delena under a Creative Commons license. You can get them here. The second Peace Button is what the user clicks on, whether to select a piece to pick up or select a destination tile. So let's look at the first procedure I wrote for Cozy Chess. The first procedure I wrote for Cozy Chess is named Draw Board. It is called just once when you first open the program and does just what it says on the tin. It draws the board. Imagine for a moment that we're back at that physical table with the robot arm, except now we've given it a black permanent marker to hold and put a blank piece of wood in front of it. What instructions would you give a robot arm to draw you a chessboard? How about, hey robot arm, start 20 millimeters from the top of the board and 70 millimeters from the left side of the board, draw me a 58 by 58 millimeter square. That's a good start, but you would only get one square, so now let's improve upon that. Hey robot arm, start 20 millimeters from the top of the board, count to 8, and each time you say a number, go 70 millimeters from the left side of the board and draw me a 58 by 58 millimeter square. Those instructions will get you a lovely column of squares on the left side of the board. We can improve it again. Hey robot, start 20 millimeters from the top of the board, count to 8, and each time you say a number, go 70 millimeters from the left side of the board and start counting to 8 in French. Each time you say a French number, draw me a 58 by 58 millimeter square, then move your marker 58 millimeters to the right. That will get you a lovely 8 by 8 grid. But to make it look like a chessboard, you'll also want the robot to color in every second square. So you need one more instruction, something like, also be counting up in Spanish. Add 1 to your Spanish count every time you draw a square. If the Spanish number you say is odd, color in the square. Now the robot arm does not actually need to speak, much less speak 3 different languages, because keeping multiple counts going and keeping them straight is precisely the skill that computers are better at than humans. But change the millimeters to pixels, and what I've described is exactly how the draw board function works. Let's read through it line by line. This is the name of the procedure. This means, check it out, I'm going to create some variables that will only be used in this procedure. There are the 5 variables. All of them are integers. POSX is the one used to keep track of my current position on the x-axis. POSY is for the same on the y-axis. A, B, and Z are the current numbers I'm on in the English, French, and Spanish counts. Begin. Stuff that is in green is just notes I've put in to make my code more readable. Start 20 millimeters from the top of the board. The compiler gets grumpy if it isn't sure all of your variables are initialized. That's why that's there. We're making 8 rows here, people, so be counting from 1 to 8 in English. We're making 8 squares per row, so in between each pair of English numbers, be counting from 1 to 8 in French. Oh, and also be counting in Spanish. And if you're starting a new row, then move 58 pixels down from where you are. Go 70 pixels from the left side of the board. If you're not starting a new row, but just making the next square in the current row, go over 58 pixels to the right so that you're on the right side of the square you just placed instead of on the left side. At last, it is time to draw a rectangle. Which of our 64 tile records are we concerned with right now? Board 1-1, board 7-5, board 8-2. The one corresponding to our English and French counters, whichever one we're on, create a rectangle that will be its underlay. All this line does is ensure that the rectangle stays in the proper spot even if the user resizes the game window. The rectangle is 58 pixels by 58 pixels, and located where the robot arm currently is. It has a black outline. Oh, and what Spanish number are you on? If it's odd, the rectangle should be black. If it's even, it should be transparent. Okay, now let's draw the interactable rectangle that sits on top of the underlay. Create that rectangle, same size, same space. This is going to have an image of a chess piece on it. That should stretch to fill the whole of the rectangle. And when the user clicks on this rectangle, we want it to run a different procedure called click any tile. Close both loops and the procedure. Congratulations, Kendra of 2006, you've read your first Delphi procedure. Now remember a few minutes back when Jerry Ryan was on the screen and I said that each of these tile records contained 9 pieces of data and 7 of the 9 were invisible units of information? The two most basic are the strings called team and piece. Team records whether the tile is occupied by a black piece, a white piece, or is empty. Piece records whether the tile is occupied by a king or a pawn or whatever else. Here is a piece of a procedure called reset pieces. Unlike draw board, which is called only when the game first boots up, reset pieces is called every time the user starts a fresh chess match. It gets the pieces to their starting positions. As you can see, it has the exact same double for loop structure as draw board. I even used the variable names A and B again, but I didn't have to. Let's read through this code. For every row and for every square of each row, do the following. Forget the previous game. Set the current tile to unoccupied. The top two rows have black pieces in them. The bottom two rows have white pieces in them. The second and seventh rows have pawns in them. The top and bottom rows are the ones with interesting pieces, so if you're in one of those, here are where the rooks, knights, bishops, queen, and king go. Now, question for you, 2006 Kendra. If the only procedures in the game were draw board, reset pieces, and one that said when the game starts, call draw board and reset pieces, what would the user see when the game boots up? The answer is that the user would see a black and clear 8x8 grid, the board, but they would not see any of Danielle Delena's beautiful chess pieces. Why not? Reset pieces only stores the strings that say black and bishop in the tile records. It doesn't tell the tile's dot piece button rectangle to load the appropriate picture. I named the procedure that does that piece icon agreement. Again, we have a two-loop structure. If this tile does not have a white or a black piece in it, fill the piece button rectangle with a bitmap found in the assets folder and the pieces subfolder named null.png. It's a picture of nothing. Why load a picture of nothing instead of setting the rectangle to invisible? It's a personal preference. Otherwise, if the tile's team is not none, which is to say if it is either black or white, then fill the piece button rectangle with a bitmap found in the assets folder and the pieces subfolder named... The pieces in the folder are appropriately named Black Bishop or White Knight or whatever, so we can use the strings that we assigned in the reset pieces procedure to get the right one. In case you're wondering about the wild colored pieces in there, they are used in some of Cozy Chess's advanced features like Strategist Mode and Training Wheels Mode. Now that you've seen three real procedures, let's go back to the pseudocode from earlier that describes an actual chess move occurring. This is the actual code. When the computer is playing a move of the immortal game written in my four-letter notation, say 4836, there is some code before this that sets source A and source B to 4 and 8 respectively, the coordinates of the moving piece's starting position, and sets A and B to 3 and 6 respectively, because those are the coordinates of the piece's destination. Let's plop in the numbers. So then this code says, hey tile 3, 6, yeah, you in the third row, sixth column? Forget whether you were just holding a black piece or a white piece or weren't occupied, because as of this moment, you belong to the army that tile 4, 8 currently belongs to. And I don't care if you were just holding a piece or not, forget about that. You are now holding the piece type that is on tile 4-8. And as for you, tile 4-8, you are now an unoccupied square because the piece you were holding has officially vamoosed. That's how my four-digit notation works. So far, we have been talking about getting the four digits from a file that stores a save game. But when an actual user plays the game, it works the same way. When I click this square to select its pawn as the piece I'm going to move, that gives me the first two digits of the move. The starting cell is 7-4. When I click here as the place I'm going to move to, it gives me the second two digits of the code, 5-4. This is actually all the code you'd need to have a game that works just as well as a physical wooden chessboard on your kitchen table. Alas, players want more from a computer chess game than that. They want a board that enforces the rules of chess.
Yo, what was that? Castle can't move like that. Yo, castle move up and down or sideways like.
On the wooden board, there's nothing physically stopping you from taking your queen, plunking it down in place of the opponent's king, and saying, "Yay, I win!" The challenge of programming computer chess, then, is to restrict the player's options to their legal moves. What are the rules of chess, and how do you program them? As I see it, there are five categories of rules. Rules governing turn-taking, rules describing the piece's normal moves, rules governing three special moves, castling, promotion, and en passant, rules about check, and rules about the different ways the game can end. Getting turn-taking to work is very simple. I have a string variable called current player that is always set to white or black. Within the procedure next move that I call whenever it's time for someone to make a move are the lines that mean, hey, current player variable who can only remember one move at a time, if you were just now remembering the word white, remember the word black instead. But if you weren't just now remembering the word white, start doing that now. That guarantees that current player will switch back and forth between white and black and back again. You'll see I also have a string variable called opponent to hold the opposite. That wasn't strictly necessary, but made for more readable code. On to piece movement. What happens in the next move procedure after we know whose turn it is that it fills a list called candidate moves with all of the moves that the player might consider making, formatted in our handy-dandy four-digit notation. Why we make that list will be explained in a few moments, but as for how we do it, we once again rely on the double for loop structure that we use whenever we have to do something to each of our 64 records. We look at each tile in turn to see if its .team string is the same as the current player string, which it will be if it is a tile with one of the current player's pieces sitting on it. If that is the case, we determine what type of piece it is, and then execute a section of code about how pieces of that type move. Which piece type do you think has the easiest movement to code? The easiest is the king.
Now the king, he move one space any direction he damn choose, cause he's the king. Like this, 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 all right? But he ain't got no hustle.
Consider a king at the coordinates 2, 5. These are the coordinates of the tiles it could move to. Coded in the four-digit notation, these are the moves we would want to add to the candidate's move list. They all start with 2, 5 because that's the starting position, and the remaining two digits specify the destination. Now let's generalize this for any starting coordinates A and B. These are the moves to put on our list. But there is one big but. The king may not have eight neighboring tiles. If it is on the edge of the board, it isn't allowed to go beyond it. If either of the coordinates of a destination tile is 0 or 9, then that would be over the edge of the 1 to 8 board. So we shouldn't put moves like that on our list. This is what this part of the code is about. Also, although a king can move into empty squares or by capturing into enemy squares, it can't go to a square that has one of its own team members on it. So we also need to check that the possible destination cell's .team string isn't the same as current player. Knights move strangely, but their code isn't much different from that of a king. Like a king, they have 8 possible squares to go to, fewer if any of those are over the edge of the board or currently occupied by their own team. The only difference is that either A or B, but not both, is offset by 2 units from the starting position instead of just 1. Now let's look at rook movement.
He moved like this, and like this.
The rook code is divided into 4 sections. First we discover the moves we need to add to our candidate's move list from the rook moving to the left. Then we cover it moving to the right, then up, then down. The code needs to convey that the rook can go to any of the squares it encounters in the given direction until it gets to a piece or to the edge of the board. When we want to code something that goes on and on until, we use a while loop. Here is the piece of the code about moving to the left. To start making sense of it, look at the part where moves are added to the candidate moves list coded in the four-digit fashion. CandidateMoves.Items.Add, that means put on the list, first the digits that specify the row and column of the rook's starting location, and then, since we are considering the rook moving to the left only, the row it is in will not change, so the third digit will be the same as the first one. The final digit is B plus C. Since B is the rook's starting column, what is C? It is the rook's displacement from its starting column. Since at the moment we are talking about the rook going left, the C values are going to be negative. When we do the section about the rook going to the right, the C values will be positive. For up and down, the C modifier, negative for up and positive for down, will be applied to the row, not to the column. So here's how we read the code. Start by checking if your rook can go one square to the left. NSearch is a Boolean, a variable that is either true or false, that tells us whether we've gone as far as we can in the current direction. It's going to be false until the rook reaches an occupied square. Until you either come to the leftmost tile of the board or until you get to an occupied square, do the following. Check if the square you're looking at longingly is empty. If it isn't, then change the NSearch Boolean to true to indicate that you've reached an occupied square. You can go there if it's empty, and you can go there if it's occupied by an enemy piece, that's capturing, but you cannot go there if it is currently occupied by one of your own team's pieces. So as long as that is not the case, add the 4-digit code to your moves list. Now switch your attention to the next tile to the left in preparation for going around the loop again, if needs be. That's rook movement. Bishop's movement is logically identical. The only difference is that the four directions you need to cover are the diagonals, so instead of A or B changing by some value C, both A and B change, so I needed a new variable, D.
It's the queen. She's smart, she's fierce. She move any way she want, as far as she want.
Coding queen movement requires no work, because a queen is simply the combination of a rook and a bishop. Look carefully at the rook code, and it says, if you're a rook or a queen, do this bunch of code. And the bishop stuff says, if you're a bishop or a queen, do this. Which brings us to pawns. Pesky, pesky pawns. The most complicated piece to program.
They like the soldiers. They move like this. One space forward only. Except when they fight. And it's like this.
Unlike the other pieces, they are directional. So it matters whose turn it is. White pawns can only move up the board toward lower numbered rows, while black pawns can only move down the board toward higher numbered rows. Also, unlike other pieces, they move differently if they are going to an unoccupied tile compared to if they are capturing an enemy tile. Plus, there is the odd business of being able to move two rows on your first move, which doesn't apply if the intermediate square is occupied. It's a lot. I'm not going to explain it in this video. And it brings us to a lot more, the special moves rules category. There are three special moves in chess, castling, en passant, and pawn promotion. They are so special that they break the 4-digit coding system that I've been celebrating thus far. A robot hand is able to execute all the other moves in chess by knowing only where to pick up a piece from and where to plunk it down. These moves require to do something in addition. When you castle, you move a piece, the king, from a source tile to a destination tile, but then you also have to move a rook. I add a letter to the end of the 4-letter move code to flag special moves and to trigger these additional actions. I use C for castling, E for en passant, Q for promoting to a queen, and K, B, and R for the rare occasions that someone underpromotes to a knight, bishop, or rook. I'm not going to go through the special code for the special moves, but suffice it to say, it caused me some headaches. The rules pertaining to check are as follows. A player is not allowed to put themselves in check, and a player who is in check must get themselves out of it. These two rules are so easily stated, and yet, they completely change how you have to code computer chess. They are the reason the next move procedure generates a candidate's moves list that includes all of the possible moves for all of the current player's pieces. When I first started coding Cozy Chess and hadn't fully thought it through, it wasn't until a player clicked on the piece that they planned to move that I ran through the piece movement code relevant to that particular piece. It generated a list of moves for that particular piece and highlighted them as possibilities. But consider a board setup like this. If I clicked on this pawn, the movement code about pawns would indicate that the pawn has two possible moves, moving here or capturing here, and it would highlight them as options. But under the check move rules, I should actually be forbidden from moving that pawn because it is what is protecting my king from the black bishop. Up until now, all the code we've looked at has been about the present moment of the chess game. Now, because of the check move rules, we need to forecast the future. The computer needs to ask itself, if the player were to make this move, would the resulting board position be one in which one of the enemy pieces threatens the current player's king? If so, then it is an illegal move that violates the rules about check. How Cozy Chess works now is that in the next move procedure, after generating the complete candidate's move list, it goes through each move on that list and runs a procedure called Simulate Move. Simulate Move tries performing the move and then analyzes the resulting board position. If the resulting board position is one in which an enemy piece is attacking the current player's king, then that move violates the rules about check. If that isn't the case, then it is a legal move and gets added to a new list called legal moves. Now, when a player clicks the piece they plan to move, all the code does is search the legal moves list for any moves that start at that piece's position and highlights their destination tiles as options. Which brings us to the final rules category, those governing how the game ends. A bonus of the legal moves list is that it makes the end of the game very easy to code. If after going through the process that generates the legal moves list, there are no items in the list, the current player has no possible moves. If they are currently in check, then they have been checkmated. If not, the game is a stalemate. In off-the-board chess, there are actually a few other ways a game can end. A player can lose on time, but there are no chess clocks in cozy chess. Taking as long as you want to make a move is part of what makes it so cozy. A real-world game can end in an agreement to draw. But I didn't bother coding that into Cozy Chess because anytime a player feels done with a particular match, they can just click the new game button and be done with it. Real world games can also end because 50 moves have occurred without a capture or a pawn move, or because a single board position has repeated 3 times. I should probably have coded those into Cozy Chess, but I just haven't bothered to do so. At long last, we come back to the post-it note. Why does my 4-digit notation not need to indicate that a move results in a check, which standard notation for humans accomplishes with a plus sign? Because the moves the following player can make are automatically restricted to those which will get them out of check. Put another way, the game knows there is a state of check without it being coded in the moves notation. That, Kendra of 2006, is all you need to know to program chess on the computer for 2 human players passing the mouse back and forth. But you are more ambitious than that. You vowed to program chess with an AI opponent. Luckily, because of the way we designed the program so far, there is already a place in the code that it makes sense for our AI to live. At the start of every turn, the simulate move procedure gets run on each candidate move and analyzes the resulting board position to see if the current player's king would be in check. At the same time, we can analyze the resulting board position for other positive and negative characteristics and assign it a quality score so the AI can choose a good move. I created a string variable called favorite option to hold the move the AI currently intends to make in our 4-digit notation, and an integer variable called score to beat to hold that move's quality score. In these 2 lines of code, I just set the defaults. I say the AI intends to pick the first item on the candidate's move list and assume that it has an impossibly low negative score. Then it goes through every item on the candidate's moves list and runs the simulate move procedure. It gives a score to the board position that would result and assigns it to an integer variable called this option scored. If I always wanted optimal play for my AI, the next bit of code would say that if this option scored is higher than the current score to beat, the move under consideration would become the new favorite option and its score would become the new score to beat, guaranteeing that after going through the entire candidate's move list, favorite option will be set to the move with the highest score. But I don't actually want identical play for my AI all the time. I want to code in the possibility for slightly worse but less predictable choices to keep the games more interesting. So the code as it actually appears in Cozy Chess replaces the old favorite move if the one under consideration is evaluated to be 3 quality points better. If it is assessed as just 1 or 2 points higher or equivalent, the program essentially flips a coin to decide whether to adopt it as the new favorite or not. So, what characteristics does the bot use to distinguish a good move from a bad one? There are over 20 of them. But as an example, consider these most basic principles. It is good to capture an enemy piece, especially if you don't put your capturing piece at risk in the process. Putting your capturing piece at risk is okay, though, if the piece you are capturing is better than the piece you lose, i.e. taking a queen for the cost of a pawn. If the piece you capture and the piece you might lose are of equal value, a fair trade, then whether that is a good move for you depends on other factors, including which player currently has more material to work with. How did I program all of that? Back in my definition of the tile record, I gave each tile 2 integers called black vision and white vision, representing how many pieces of the relevant color could hypothetically capture a piece on that tile. In this board position, this tile, E5, has a black vision of 1 because there is only 1 black piece, the pawn currently on D6, that could go there if it were occupied. It has a white vision of 4 because a white pawn, queen, bishop, and knight could all go there. This code, which is only run with regards to captures, states that if you are white and the tile you are going to has a black vision of 0, Or if you are black and the tile that you want to go to has a white vision of zero, that is, if you can capture what is on the tile without putting your own piece in immediate risk, that's a good thing. Your assessment of this possible move should increase by val of cap. The value of the piece you are capturing, 3 for a bishop, 5 for a rook, etc., multiplied by a configurable parameter, more about those in a bit, which by default is set to 5. So, if you can capture a rook without putting your attacking piece at risk, the move you are considering is 25 quality units better than it otherwise would be. This code stipulates that if you are considering a capture where the enemy team's vision is more than 0, that is, a place where you could be captured, consider the value of the piece you are capturing minus the value of your own piece, which may well be lost. So, capturing a rook at the cost of a pawn would be considered as plus 20, as opposed to plus 25 above, because of the lost pawn. Capturing a bishop at the cost of a queen would be considered as negative 30. But is it good to trade pieces tit for tat? I leave that up to the user. If you explore Cozy Chess's options, the bots are actually fully configurable. You can set the white bot to love capturing en passant and to prefer queenside castling. I use Delphi's record structure to define a cluster of information called a configurable, and I created an array of 22 configurables to house the 22 different parameters the user can adjust which the bots use when evaluating potential moves. This is the code that ensures that in the absence of a value chosen by the user in the Configure Bots menu, the values are set to defaults defined by me. The 14th configurable parameter is called Simplify. It represents how much the bot adheres to the general maxim taught to beginner chess players that if you have a material advantage, that is, if you have captured more of your opponent's pieces than they have of yours, you should trade pieces of equal value when possible. More advanced chess players know that rules of thumbs like this don't always apply. I shouldn't trade my bishop for my opponent's bishop just because I'm up points if, say, my bishop has lots of room to maneuver and my opponent's bishop is blocked in. There's also the question of individual style. Some players avoid trades because they prefer complicated board positions. If the simplify parameter is assigned a high value, the bot will be trade happy. If it is set to a low value, the bot will be trade averse. Here is the code where this value is used. It is only called when considering a capture where your capturing piece would be put in jeopardy. It states, if the piece you would capture and the piece you would put at risk are of equal value, then if you are the player who currently has the material advantage, add to your current evaluation of this option the value assigned to parameter 14, the simplify parameter. If you are the player without the material advantage, subtract that value. The AI is simply a whole lot of little calculations like that. Put enough of them together, and young Kendra, you realize your long-ago dream.
Wahoo!
Flashback to 2006. You may be wondering what I did for my final project since I wasn't yet able to make chess. I made a digital scorekeeper for a card game that I love. The game is called, depending where you live, Offshoot, Opshaw, Up the River, Down the River, or Nomination Whist. My final project was literally just the scorekeeper. It didn't deal cards or have a graphic user interface. It was a command prompt style script that asked whether each player had scored in a given hand, and if so, added their new points to their current score. It is a marvel to me now that that project took me hours and hours of work. Deeply contented work that instilled in me an enduring love of programming, but hours and hours of work nonetheless. Today I could whip that up in 15 minutes, which is a really comforting testament to how much I've learned, even though I'm still a beginner with so much more I want to learn. All this to say that now that I'm done with Cozy Chess, my current project is taking me back to the game that launched it all. I'm making Offshoot, Up the River, Down the River, whatever you want to call it, again, except this time it's a full game with animation and AI opponents. And I'm having just as much fun as I did in 2006.